Welcome to Cabinet Conversations. I'm Alex Wood, Education Programs Manager at Ford's Theater. If you are joining us for the first time, this is our live series exploring creativity, history, and leadership. You can learn more and explore our past programs by visiting our website at www.fords.org. Since Abraham Lincoln's assassination at Ford's Theater on April 14, 1865, Americans have argued about the roles the 16th president played in the great issues of the Civil War era and how we should remember him. At Ford's Theater, we see Lincoln as both a great leader and a flawed human being. The title of our program today is one of these questions. Was Lincoln the great emancipator? We're talking with two historians who have literally written books on the topic. Today, we welcome Dr. Edna Greene Medford and Dr. Jonathan W. White. Dr. Edna Greene Medford is a professor in the Department of History in the College of Arts and Sciences at Howard University. Specializing in 19th century African American history, she teaches courses in the Jacksonian era, Civil War and Reconstruction, and African American history to 1877. She is a member of the Ford's Theater Advisory Council, a former chair of Howard University's Department of History, and former director of the department's graduate and undergraduate programs. Dr. Medford is an alumna of Hampton University, the University of Illinois Urbana, and the University of Maryland College Park, where she received her PhD in United States history. Dr. Jonathan W. White is Associate Professor of American Studies at Christopher Newport University and is an award-winning author and editor of more than 10 books and more than 100 articles, essays, and reviews on the American Civil War, American founding, 19th century America, and constitutional and legal history. He is a member of the Ford's Theater Advisory Council and the editorial board of the Pennsylvania Magazine of History and Biography. Dr. White serves on the boards of directors of the Abraham Lincoln Institute, the Abraham Lincoln Association, the Lincoln Forum, and the John L. Now III Center for Civil War History at the University of Virginia. Welcome to you both. As a reminder to all our viewers, we are taking your questions on our social media platforms. Please feel free to submit those so that we may share them with our guests during the program. All right, let's begin. It's important to understand that Lincoln didn't do emancipation all by himself. But as Frederick Douglass said in his 1876 speech in memory of Lincoln, Lincoln was the one under whom emancipation happened. As we talk about the arc of Lincoln's legacy and his role in emancipation, we're not stripping Lincoln of what he did, but enriching this legacy to acknowledge the many facets and voices that made emancipation happen. Edna, let's begin with you. In your book, Lincoln and Emancipation, you discuss the idea of this uneasy and informal alliance between President Lincoln and Black Americans. Can you talk a little bit about that?
From the very beginning of the war, there was a disagreement between Lincoln and African Americans about what the war should actually be about. African Americans certainly understood that it was about preservation of the Union. But from the start, they saw this as an opportunity to secure their freedom. Lincoln and Congress and the North in general certainly didn't see it that way at the beginning. But African Americans, realizing that this was their opportunity, did everything they could to bring Lincoln and Congress and the North along to their way of thinking. And so eventually what does happen is Lincoln and African Americans are on the same page. And so they may be approaching this from with different motivations, but they're trying to get to the same end. And the end is to preserve the Union, and certainly after the Emancipation Proclamation, to free enslaved people as well.
And in a lot of ways, they had to sort of push Lincoln toward emancipation. Can you talk a little bit about
that? They certainly did have to push him. You know, Lincoln certainly understood that he had to be very careful about how he proceeded, because there were lots of folk in the North who really didn't care about whether or not slavery ended or freeing those people who were enslaved at the moment in the Confederate South. There were also, of course, the border states that he had to keep in check. You know, we think about places like Maryland, where they remained in the Union ostensibly, but they were certainly very closely allied with the Confederacy as well. Many, many of those border state residents were. And so while Lincoln is attempting to keep those states in the Union, African Americans are doing whatever they can to press him to move more swiftly toward slavery. And, you know, we talk about, more swiftly toward freedom. We talk about the role that Frederick Douglass played in trying to press Lincoln to move forward more swiftly. But there were many other African Americans who were doing the same thing. And just ordinary African Americans were also pressuring him. People who were enslaved, people who were in the Confederacy, were leaving the Confederacy, although Lincoln was saying this is not a war about slavery. At least he's doing that before the proclamation is issued. Despite that, African Americans are leaving in droves. But what really is important is that Lincoln does eventually decide that he's going to issue that proclamation. And it makes a world of difference to African Americans. I think we do a disservice to the role of the proclamation to simply say that it was meaningless.
So I think there's a lot of confusion about what the Emancipation Proclamation actually did. So maybe, John, can you give us a 101 course? What was the Emancipation Proclamation?
Sure. So the Emancipation Proclamation freed the slaves in the areas of rebellion. And so Lincoln did this for very specific reasons. He knew he couldn't touch slavery constitutionally in the border states, places like Maryland, which Edna mentioned, or Kentucky or Delaware or Missouri, because the constitutional understanding at the time was that slavery was an institution controlled at the state level and the federal government didn't have the right to interfere with it. Now, Southerners in the antebellum period, white Southerners, I should say, were more than happy to have the federal government protect slavery in ways that they could try to get. But the general understanding was the federal government, Congress, the president has no ability to interfere with slavery where it exists, where it's protected by state law. Now, what Lincoln does is he declares slavery over in the states in rebellion, in the areas of rebellion. So he actually exempts areas like where I am here in Tidewater, Virginia, that are under Union control. And he does that for a very specific constitutional reason. He wants to make sure that if the Emancipation Proclamation gets challenged in court, it'll be upheld. And so he says, I'm doing this as a war measure. I'm doing it in my role as Commander-in-Chief of the Army and Navy so that I can win the war and preserve the Union. Now, one of the things that people often say about the Emancipation Proclamation is it didn't free anybody because it didn't free any. Lincoln was declaring free people over whom he had no control at the moment he signed the Emancipation Proclamation on January 1st, 1863. But in the process, what happens is as the Union armies move forward, freedom will go with them. And as enslaved people flee to Union lines, they will now have legal protection, legal freedom being given by the presence of Union armies. And not only that, the proclamation officially authorizes Black men to join the Union Army. And so in the course of the following 2 years, nearly 200,000 Black men will join the Union armies, and they will participate in the process of fighting to extend freedom throughout the Confederacy.
And if I might add, slavery does not end even in the Confederacy. It's a promise of freedom,
right.
A promise of freedom to those people who were enslaved at the moment in those areas. But Lincoln and the North understood that once the war was over, that might not hold up. And so that's why the 13th Amendment was so important. And also because there were over 800,000 people who were not covered by the proclamation. And we sometimes forget that there were at least 8,000 African-Americans who were enslaved in Indian territory. So native groups were holding enslaved people and were not affected by the proclamation, their enslaved laborers. And in fact, those folk weren't even covered by the 13th Amendment. A separate agreement had to be made between the United States government and those Indian nations in Indian territory in order for their enslaved laborers to be free. And that didn't happen until March 1866.
Right.
Yeah, so we start to see how the Emancipation Proclamation is part of a strategy more so than a sweeping act or document.
Mm-hmm. But an important strategy. I remember that the I read where the editor of the New York Anglo-African referred to it was a weekly newspaper. He referred to the proclamation as a pillar of flame beckoning the slaves to the dreamed of promise of freedom. And that's exactly what it was. That's how they saw it. It doesn't mean that they were not leaving, you know, they were not freeing themselves before Lincoln issued the proclamation, but the proclamation did matter to them because many more left the Confederacy after Lincoln issued the proclamation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that promise of freedom and forever free, right? That's a word that's in the proclamation. Mm-hmm. So since this was all part of a strategy on Lincoln's part, how did we get to this place where the Emancipation Proclamation and enlisting Black soldiers was politically feasible for Lincoln? Because it certainly doesn't seem like he was willing to tackle that at the beginning of the war.
Should I answer that?
Go ahead.
Okay, great. Well, I think part of it is that I think Lincoln decided very early on in the war. I used to think that it took him too long, but when I look back at it, I think he really did decide this fairly early in the war that slavery was the cause of the war and that something had to be done about ending it. And he attempted to get the border states to do it because he believed that this had to be state action. He didn't want it done through military action. The states should make the decision that slavery was not right for themselves or for the country, and they should eliminate it on their own. But of course, he struck out every chance, every time he attempted to convince them that they needed to do something. And so the war is not going well for the North. White soldiers are wondering why they're the only ones fighting this war. They are not as enthusiastic about it as they were when it first started, when they thought it would only take a month or two to end. And so it becomes a war of attrition. They need bodies. And what better place to get them than folk who are enslaved, who would be inclined to fight against their owners anyway, it was assumed. And of course, Black men had been clamoring for that opportunity to enter the war because this gave them the chance to show that they were truly men, that they were brave, they were courageous, they could be patriotic as well. And more importantly, they could get their freedom that way.
Yeah, and gain the rights of citizenship. You prove your manhood on the battlefield, you're willing to sacrifice your life, you deserve then the right to vote. And that's going to be one of the strong arguments that's made in the years after the war. I think Edna beautifully captured the sort of political considerations Lincoln had to face. He couldn't risk losing the border states in 1861. He couldn't risk losing Kentucky because then the Ohio River, which is a major commercial thoroughfare, is now going to be subject to Confederate attacks from Kentucky. He can't afford to lose Maryland because if Maryland falls to the Confederacy, he will be in a national capital that is surrounded by an enemy nation. And so politically, he knows in the spring of 1861, if he strikes out against slavery in a direct way like that, it's going to cause these border slave states to join the Confederacy. Beyond that, if he had done it in April or May of 1861, he wouldn't have had the power to enforce it. He didn't have an army yet that he could use to wage war against the Southern states, and it just wouldn't have been viable. But he does, as Edna pointed out, he does start taking steps against slavery very early in the war. And one of the things I think of is as early as May of 1861, Lincoln begins to push to really destroy the illegal transatlantic slave trade. And that is something that presidents before the war had just kind of let slide. And slave traders are still engaging in this nefarious traffic, and they never see real punishment. But Lincoln, in May of 1861, tells his interior secretary, this is something I want you to handle and finish off for good. And then, as Edna pointed out, he has this border state strategy where he tries to get the border states to accept compensated emancipation. He says to Congress, allocate money, give it to the border states, have their legislatures buy out slavery. And he figures, I'll start with Delaware. I think there's 1,700 or 1,800 slaves in Delaware. It can't be that great of an interest to them. But Lincoln was wrong. He was naive in that. And even in the small state of Delaware, with such a small number of slaves, they slave owners hold to their quote-unquote property so tenaciously that they won't let go. And ultimately, Lincoln is going to have to take another strategy, which ultimately then will be the Emancipation Proclamation and then the 13th Amendment.
So he does try compensated emancipation in the District of Columbia, and it works. It happens. We're actually coming up on our Emancipation Day holiday next week, April 16th. I guess either of you, but maybe Edna, since you're here in Washington with us, do you want to talk a little bit about DC emancipation and Emancipation Day and how it's been celebrated and acknowledged ever since 1862?
Off and on, yes. There were a few years that it sort of lapsed. But yeah, but we need to remember that emancipation in the District of Columbia is actually something that is ushered in by Congress and approved by Lincoln, of course. It would not have been law if Lincoln had not signed off on it. But Lincoln was a little bit reluctant about DC compensated emancipation, not because he didn't want to see emancipation occur. He certainly did. But because the local residents didn't have the opportunity to vote on it. And part of his plan for emancipation, and a plan that goes back to when he was in Congress and he was trying to fashion some kind of a bill that would cover emancipation in the District of Columbia, it was that it had to be compensated. It had to be with the consent of the local people. And it had to be accompanied by colonization, and it had to be gradual. And the interesting thing is, DC emancipation was not gradual. There was no consent from the local people, but there was that push for colonization after it occurred. So he was a little, not hesitant about it, I think, but a little concerned, because the locals had not voted for it. He really did believe that the Constitution protected, of course, protected property, private property, and enslaved people were seen as property. And so you have to be careful if you are not to infringe on the rights of people to own that property. The interesting thing about DC emancipation was that the compensated emancipation was that the slaveholder was compensated, but the enslaved people who were being freed were not compensated. And if I'm remembering correctly, they had to pay for that piece of paper that showed that they were free. But no one thought to compensate them for the many years of toil. And if you look at the list, the compensation list, and you see how people are valued, it's just like cattle or a piece of property of some sort. Someone's worth $25, you know, or even less than that. Someone who has some kind of mental issue or something, or maybe too old. Someone my age would not have been valued at very much, because the prime years would have been gone in terms of labor, the kind of labor that people are doing in the district. But certainly the freed were very pleased with it. DC had very few enslaved people left as well, as John indicated. In Delaware, they were very few. In DC, there were about 3,100. Yeah. The vast majority of Black people in the district were already free. But still, there was resistance among the local residents to to freedom. But the folk who got their freedom and the ones who were already freed always remembered DC emancipation, April 16th, 1862. The bill was passed by Congress on April 11th and Lincoln signed it on the 16th. And there's been a great deal of debate about why he waited. Part of it was it came to him over the weekend, but there was still a couple of days that he could have signed it a little bit earlier. So we're still arguing about exactly why he delayed. And the possibilities are fascinating. So I would encourage people to read about why Lincoln may have delayed.
Yeah, if I can add a couple things to that, to Edna's discussion of property, two aspects come to mind. Just for viewers at home, one of the reasons that they pushed for compensation is they believed that the Fifth Amendment prohibited the government taking property without compensation to the owner. Mm-hmm. And so they were worried that without that provision, and the same thing with the border states, that the quote unquote taking of property would be struck down in the courts. And to Edna's point about the valuation, they actually, if memory serves correct, they contracted with slave traders from Baltimore who were brought in to try to figure out what is a person worth, which is remarkable to think about that at that point, the federal government's contracting with slave traders to do that. There are some interesting stories that come out of the compensation. There were some free African Americans in Washington, D.C. who had purchased the freedom of their family members. And there are a couple of African-American men on the list of people who were compensated. Mm-hmm. But because what they did was they said, I purchased my wife and children. I am going to claim them so that I get compensation for our freedom, essentially. And in a few cases, Black men were able to win some money back from not nearly what they had spent to purchase their mm-hmm. own or their family's freedom. But it's an interesting twist in the story. And Edna talked about the delay. During that delay, several delegations went to meet with Lincoln. And there were some border state people who went and met with Lincoln and said, don't sign this law. It's a bad thing to do. But one of the people who met with Lincoln was a Black minister named Daniel Payne. Mm-hmm. And this is the first documented case of Lincoln meeting with an African American at the White House. He meets with Lincoln, I think, on April 14th. And goes and has a 45-minute conversation with Lincoln and says, you should really sign this law. And Lincoln keeps his cards close to the chest and doesn't tell Payne what he's going to do at that point. Lincoln, in fact, says, I've had other people come into me saying, don't sign the law. But Payne was really struck by this conversation he had with Lincoln, how kind Lincoln was in meeting with him. And before he left, Payne left him several copies of the Christian Recorder so that Lincoln could see what the Black community was saying about the war. And I'd like to think that Lincoln may have read those issues of the Christian Recorder and gotten a sense of what African Americans were thinking about his role and the war in general.
Indeed.
We have a question from our audience. The questioner asks, my understanding is that there were three cities where the Black populations at the beginning of the Civil War were majority free, Washington, Baltimore, and St. Louis, all border cities. How did these large free Black populations support the newly free, and especially those who were self-emancipating?
Yeah, I think it really depended upon where you were. Certainly in Washington, there was a bit of, there was a clash kind of, more of a cultural kind of division between those who had been freed in D.C. before the war and those are part of compensated emancipation. And of course, those who come in later, because D.C. is overrun by people coming in from the plantations, coming in from Maryland, even after compensated emancipation, they're coming in from Maryland when they really are not supposed to be there. They don't get their freedom just because they're entering DC, because Maryland was one of the border states and slaveholding was still legal. But those that are coming in from Virginia, they're coming in there, they're coming in from all over the South, actually. Understandably so. I mean, D.C. is the center of the federal government, and they're trying to escape slavery. And so there's a great deal of division there because you're having people coming from the plantations who were perhaps not as genteel as the folk who were already there. Many of the Black people in DC had been domestic servants. And what's happening is they're dealing with people who are coming in from the farms and the plantations. And there's that cultural clash there. But some do assist. Some help people to get jobs. And they help to reunite families when they can. But you've got people like Elizabeth Keckley and others who are part of the Contraband Relief Association. And their aim is to help those people who the contraband or people who have been able to escape the Confederacy, who are just trying to survive during the war. So they're sending them clothing and medical supplies and whatever else their needs are. But it really does depend upon where you're located, what group is coming in. Understandably, there's some cultural clashes.
Yeah, and in regards to Baltimore and St. Louis, Maryland doesn't become a free state until November 1st, 1864. So that's why, as Edna pointed out, slaves from Maryland, they're not going to flee to Baltimore so much. They're going to go to Washington, where there's contraband camps set up and they'll be protected as opposed to remaining in Maryland. And then St. Louis, Missouri, doesn't have freedom come until 1865. And so there are contraband camps that are set up along the Mississippi River at various points. But I think Edna's right that the main focus to think about that question is Washington.
Thank you. I think so. We're starting to think a little bit about these interpersonal relationships, and I want to go back to Lincoln's interactions with Black Americans. And John, you're writing a book, and you found a whole bunch of letters that Lincoln received while president from African Americans. And how did you discover these letters and what did they reveal?
Yeah, so I have a book coming out this fall with University of North Carolina Press called To Address You as My Friend, African Americans Letters to Abraham Lincoln. It has 125 letters, about 125 letters from Black men and women, slave and free, North and South to Lincoln. I will say though that the best part of the book is the foreword by Edna. I'm very grateful to Edna for writing it. It's, you know, only 14 of these letters have appeared in print before, and in their entirety, in the volumes of the Freedmen and Southern Society Project. And I actually dedicated the book to the teachers that Edna and I both had at the University of Maryland. They unearthed an incredible, and are still unearthing, an incredible amount of documentation at the National Archives that traces the history of emancipation, and that for the last 30 years has really shifted the way we think about emancipation in the U.S. So I have some of the sources that they use, but then I was also able to look at other records as well that the Freedmen and Southern Society Project didn't look at. So for example, I look at pardon records. We talked about Washington, D.C. If you were convicted of a crime in the District of Columbia, you would go to the president to seek pardon, not because there was no governor, not like in a state crime. And so I have a number of letters of African Americans who wrote to Lincoln seeking pardon for crimes or writing on behalf of people who had been convicted of crimes. And those letters give an incredible perspective of race relations in the District of Columbia. There's one letter from a man who was convicted for selling alcohol to a white soldier. And he writes to Lincoln and describes how he thought he couldn't say no in that case when the soldier wanted alcohol, but it violated the law. And so he gets convicted and he writes to Lincoln and asks for pardon. Or there's an instance of a young Black woman, late teenage, early 20s, I forget her age. She gets convicted for stealing from someone else. And her mother writes to Lincoln and says, essentially, my daughter was a knucklehead, but I'm working on her and she's going to get her life straight. And if you pardon her, I'm sure she'll do the right thing moving forward. And so those kind of letters and the way that both African Americans and white Americans in that era felt comfortable writing to Lincoln, but especially for Black Americans to see in Lincoln a president that they can reach out to. Never before had African Americans written to a president in such large numbers. And I think it says something about the connection that many Black Americans felt to Lincoln at this time.
And I think that the importance of John's book, as well, as that it's allowing people to have a voice who you don't hear that voice often enough in history. These are not people who are generally keeping diaries or who are writing letters to friends. So we try to capture their voice in whatever way we can. And it's marvelous to have that collection and just hear what people are thinking and what their concerns are, and that they expect the president of the United States to listen to mm-hmm. what they have to say.
Yeah, that's right. So often African-American voices in the 19th century are mediated through white sources. Mm-hmm. And so the only way you have a sense of what someone might have said is someone else heard it and then wrote it down. And of course, they hear certain things that may or may not have been actually said. Mm-hmm. And so in this case, you know, some of the letters were written by white teachers or by lawyers, because the writer in these cases were illiterate. But then other letters are written in the hand of the writer. And so you really get a sense of the voice of people who otherwise would be voiceless to us today, I think.
So you're reminding me of a letter that I like to sometimes use in programs I do with students, where a young Black woman who is enslaved in Maryland writes to Lincoln after mm-hmm. the Emancipation Proclamation. And she says, "I heard about this Emancipation Proclamation. Am I free? When right. will I be free?"
And Annie Davis.
Yes.
That's one of the letters that Ira Berlin and the editors of the Freedmen and Southern Society Project discovered probably 30 years ago. I do have that one in the book. And what's tragic in that case, so she writes to Lincoln because she wants to visit her family members somewhere else in Maryland. And the Emancipation Proclamation did not include Maryland. So she wrote in August of 1864. It wouldn't be until November that she would in law be free in that case.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Oh, it's going to be so amazing to put voices and names to these stories and illuminate this whole part of the history that just hasn't been recognized for so long, because it just hasn't been digitized, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So one of the relationships that we do know a lot about is Lincoln's relationship with Frederick Douglass. And it's the subject of our radio play, Necessary Sacrifices. And Douglass is, in that play in particular, and we see in Douglass's writings and his letters and his speeches about Lincoln, how he pushed, sort of returning to this idea, we talked a little bit about it this earlier, but that tension between sort of Lincoln's political strategizing and then people like Douglass, activists who are pushing for emancipation to happen and for civil rights and equality to happen faster. Can we talk a little bit about, can we go back and talk a little bit more about how Black Americans pushed Lincoln on civil and political rights, even beyond emancipation? So after the Emancipation Proclamation was passed, you know, how did they continue to get his ear and push on this?
Mm-hmm. Well, you have, you know, we think that the war is actually occupying everybody's time. And so they're just focused on getting Black men into the army and making sure that they have the same rights as soldiers that other people do. But there's a whole group of Black people in many of these states in the North who are pushing for civil rights during the same period. And so you've got people like Octavius Cato, and, you know, in Philadelphia, for instance, who's pushing. They're talking about equal access to the streetcars, that kind of thing. They're talking about education for their children, equal access to public school education. Excuse me. And Lincoln is drawn into that. So they are pushing for those rights. Lincoln has to make a decision about how far he's going to assist them in that. Certainly the most important way that he does is in the last speech that he makes publicly, where he's talking about wishing, the whole speech is about Reconstruction. What's to happen now that the war is pretty much over? And he's talking about the strides that Louisiana had made in terms of forming its new state constitution. And he says he's disappointed that they don't include Black men as voters in Louisiana, but it's a question that's open for consideration later on. And he's pleased that at least they didn't close the books totally. Well, we understand that Lincoln is a politician. He is the leader of the Republican Party. He's smart enough to understand that when the war is over and the Republican Party is attempting to build or to expand its presence in the South, what better way to do it than to have these Black men who are able to vote, especially if they had served the nation as soldiers. And those, of course, as well, he calls those who are the more intelligent. Mm-hmm. And we know he's talking about that certain class of people in Louisiana, the men who, many of the men who had served in the Native Guard initially, these mulattoes who are pretty much well-educated. They have some money. They're accustomed to, you know, having a lifestyle that's very different from the average Black person. So they're saying, he's saying, why not grant them, you know, the right to vote? At the same time, you've got men in North Carolina and in Tennessee and in other places writing to the president saying, okay, if we were good enough to serve, if we were good enough to shoulder a weapon and don the Union blue, we should be given those rights of citizenship, the same rights as white men. So they are constantly pressuring him to move closer and closer to full citizenship.
Yeah, I want to build on that too. In this collection of African-American correspondence with Lincoln, one of the things that a number of these writers points out is, we have been loyal the whole time. If you want to talk about a loyal population in the Confederacy, it's us. We're not in rebellion. You should give us the right to vote. And in fact, so I've got another book coming out. It'll come out on Lincoln's birthday in 2021 or 2022, called In a House Built by Slaves, African American Visitors to the Lincoln White House. And the title comes from First Lady Michelle Obama's speech at the 2016 DNC. And in this book, I have a chapter that looks at three different delegations of African-Americans who met with Lincoln to push for the right to vote. One comes from New Orleans, one comes from North Carolina, one comes from Virginia. And all three of these delegations meet with Lincoln and they say, we have been loyal. Our ancestors have been loyal. They fought in the American Revolution. They fought with Andrew Jackson in the War of 1812. We used to have the right to vote in North Carolina. The delegation from North Carolina actually was partly born free and partly born enslaved. And they go to the White House and they say, you know, up until 1835, Black men could vote in North Carolina and it didn't cause any problems. You can trust us with the right to vote again. And so in all these different ways, whether it's through editorials or through public speeches or through letters or by meeting with Lincoln, they're making these claims. And in the case of the Louisianans, two Creoles go to the White House and meet with Lincoln. They bring a petition signed by 1,000 people, including veterans of the War of 1812, asking for the right to vote. And initially they phrase it as only the elites, the wealthy, free Black population of Louisiana should be able to vote. And Lincoln says to them, this is a great, you know, document you've written. I have a couple thoughts of how we can amend it. And Lincoln sits down side by side with one of the men and they make some changes and the men end up writing a new petition that calls for a broader franchise, not just the educated, but also all Black men in Louisiana. And we know through private correspondence that Lincoln was working behind the scenes to try to get the Republicans of Louisiana to allow Black men to vote through a new state constitution. And they don't go along with it. And so then, as Edna pointed out, he publicly calls for this on April 11th, 1865. And it's the first time in American history that a sitting president publicly calls for black men to be given the right to vote. And of course, as many of the viewers probably know, John Wilkes Booth is in the audience, and he says that means N-word citizenship. That'll be the last speech he ever gives. And so these issues were intimately related with Lincoln's thinking and ultimately what would help bring about the end of Lincoln's life, unfortunately.
So you started talking about some private correspondence, and we've talked a lot about President Lincoln's political strategy. And so this, I was asked this by a student earlier this week, you know, what were Lincoln's views on race? So we have this tension between his private beliefs and his public actions. Edna, do you want to tackle that?
It's a mixed bag, actually. It's difficult to get around. First of all, Lincoln certainly understood that all Americans had the right to better themselves, and slavery prevented that. But he also, and he believed that slavery was immoral, and that it made the country look bad. But he also believed that Black people were inferior to whites. He says it's because of slavery, you know, but he still considers that there is that inferiority among African Americans. He's quite willing to tell jokes that we would consider racist and offensive today. His performance in Illinois in the debate,
Charleston.
Thank you, Charleston debate. Thanks so much. It's been a long day. Where he really does speak in a way that's offensive to African Americans today. It's hard to get around that. We certainly do understand that we have to interpret people's thinking and not, I don't want to use the word judge, but at least consider their actions in their times and according to the standards of that period. We understand that. But not everybody is telling racist jokes, you know, in the 1850s and the 1860s. Not everybody's saying that Black people are inferior for whatever reason they think they're inferior. Not everyone is telling a delegation of Black men, you're the cause of the war. It's because of your presence in America that white men are fighting. And oh, by the way, you should pack up and leave. We're not going to deport you, but we're going to encourage you to go someplace else. At the same time, he's telling them you have a right to govern yourself. So he does understand that Black people have the ability to govern themselves. He recognizes that Frederick Douglass is as worthy of recognition as any white man. I truly believe he understands that. But he's still a man of his times. He is a Southerner by birth. He has some of the same kinds of attitudes that Southern white men had during that period, and for that matter, that Northern white men and women had during that period as well. Does he believe that people have the right to freedom? Of course he does. But there are some little issues involving race that I haven't been able to resolve in my head. The fascinating thing about Lincoln is you can pick up a document any given day and look at it and think one way about Lincoln, think that you know who he is. And then you turn a page and there's something else that contradicts what you just read before. So I find him fascinating because he's such a complex historical figure. And I mean, that's the way we want them, John, I think. You know, mm-hmm. What's the point of looking at these historical figures and not seeing the complexity? We don't need a god. We need a man who was able to evolve. And we find that in Lincoln.
Yeah, I think those are great points in terms of seeing him within the context, seeing the way he changes, and seeing the way his ideas evolve over time, and his approach to the war, where he goes from March 4th, 1861, saying, I'm not going to touch slavery where it exists, to a year and a half later saying, I'm going to do that. The one thing I would add is, The context is so important. And in light of the political context in which he was operating, I do think there's more enlightenment in Lincoln than in a lot of fellow Northerners. And I think of the Charleston speech, right? Because that you pointed to the two hard ones, the Charleston speech and the meeting with the Black delegation in August of 1862, where you just wish Lincoln hadn't said the things he said. Edna and I have a mutual friend, Lucas Morell, who's written on Charleston a little bit. And Lucas has this line that I've tucked away in my mind where Lucas says, if Lincoln played the race card, Douglas played the whole deck. And the comparison between Lincoln and Douglas, I mean, Lincoln said some really bad things about African-Americans in that speech, things we wish he hadn't said. Douglas was beyond the pale in terms of white supremacist, racist speech in that very debate. And so whenever I talk about Lincoln and race, especially in the 1850s, I certainly address those ideas head on, because I don't want my students to be whitewashed and not know some of the things that he said. But I always tell them the political context in Illinois, and that Illinois in the 1850s was a white supremacist state. It was a state that white people believed was for white people, and that was it. And not only that, white men. It was a state for white men, right? So African Americans have no political rights. They cannot vote. They cannot serve on juries. They cannot serve in the militia. And not only that, in 1853, the state passed a law that made it illegal for free black people to move into the state of Illinois. And if they moved into Illinois, and Ira Berlin did a wonderful book 40 years ago about this, if a free black person moved into the free state of Illinois after this law was enacted, they would be fined $50. And if they couldn't pay that $50 fine, they would be imprisoned and then auctioned off. And a white person, could purchase their labor to pay off the fine. And so, you know, we think about Illinois as a free state, and yet there is unfree labor in Illinois. And it's within that context that Lincoln's speaking. And I would commend to all the viewers Lincoln's speech in response to the Dred Scott decision, where he argues twice in that speech, he uses an African-American woman, a hypothetical black woman, as an example of someone who deserves the right to eat the bread that she earns by the sweat of her own brow. And he actually says to this audience of white men, in this regard, she is my equal and the equal of everyone else in here. And to think about Lincoln talking to a white supremacist audience in a state like Illinois and to make a claim like that, is pretty remarkable. And so Edna's right. You know, you turn the page and there's different things on different pages, and it is what makes it interesting to be thinking about Lincoln with all these different ideas and making sense of them. And it's why I think he'll continue to be interesting. I love the way, Alex, you put it at the beginning in terms of, you know, we want to think about Lincoln as a human being. And I think too often we make him this just marble statue in Washington, D.C. We forget that he was human. He did have flaws. He had inconsistencies. And part of, I think, what makes him great is that he was able to accomplish a lot while still being a flawed person like the rest of us.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So you mentioned statues. So I want to talk about one in particular that is still standing in Washington. It had a replica that was removed in Boston, but the Emancipation statue designed by Thomas Ball. It's in Lincoln Park here in Washington, D.C. And there were multiple design submissions. But as we look at this statue and the controversy surrounding it today, we see in it this tension between Lincoln, the great emancipator, self-emancipation, and the agency of African Americans making this promise of freedom come true for themselves. And I just want to ask your personal opinions here. How do you feel about that statue, and what do you think should happen to it?
Hands off the statue. Okay. That one should not be touched. It should remain exactly where it is. I understand the concern. It shows, it implies that Lincoln is emancipating, he's helping to end slavery all by himself, and that this black man is kneeling before him. That's not the way I see the statue. I see it as something very different. That black man is, his chains are breaking and he's rising up. Whether it's suggesting that Lincoln is responsible for the breaking of the chains or not, we can argue about that. What's important about that statue is it was paid with the funds of black people. It was the effort of black people to honor a man that they thought had been central to their liberation, and he was. That doesn't mean that he did it by himself. Doesn't mean that black people were sitting by the wayside and waiting for a white man to liberate them. That's not what it means to me. It means that there was a partnership where Lincoln is doing what he can for the Union. And in doing that, he does embrace the idea of freedom for enslaved people. And enslaved people are likewise helping to free themselves. Both by running away as individuals and collectively in groups, but also by serving in the military to preserve the Union and to secure black freedom. What I would like to see done with the statue is that whole park be devoted to telling the story of emancipation so that you can have other statues there and you can show the role that black people are playing, not just as soldiers, but people like Elizabeth Keckley, who's doing her part, people like Frederick Douglass and many other black leaders and collective African-Americans who are attempting to make sure that their chance at citizenship exists. So that park could be a wonderful opportunity to do that without removing that statue.
Yeah, I agree wholeheartedly with Edna. Last summer, Edna and I were, I think, two of only three people to serve on all the three major Lincoln boards together. So we were in a lot of meetings together. And last summer, there was an email exchange that was going around the Abraham Lincoln Institute where this statue was at the center of the news and people were chiming in on what they thought should happen. And it led to a separate conversation with one of our fellow board members, Scott Sandage, where he and I were debating what was Frederick Douglass's view of this statue. And it led Scott to search on newspapers.com and find a letter to the editor of the National Republican that Douglass wrote in April of 1876, shortly after the statue was dedicated. And Douglass said, "There's room in Lincoln Park for more than one statue." And if only people had listened to Frederick Douglass 145 years ago, maybe we wouldn't have the same controversy swirling around the statue. A more complete story could have been told. Douglass said in that letter that no one monument tells a complete story. And Douglass was right. You know, Charlotte Scott, the woman who gave the first $5 for that statue, was present at the dedication in 1876. I would love to see a statue of Charlotte Scott there, a woman who had been born into slavery in Lynchburg, Virginia, becomes free, and then becomes famous across the nation. It's funny, in the 1890s, she died in 1891, I believe, and there was a push to erect a monument to her in either Marietta, Ohio, or where she had resided for the later years of the war, or in Washington, D.C. And in fact, Governor McKinley, future President McKinley, allegedly donated money to erect a statue of her. But the Washington Bee, a black newspaper in Washington, D.C., published a piece where they said, We don't need a statue of Charlotte Scott. This is her monument, this statue of Lincoln that her name is engraved on the plaque on the base is her monument. And actually in the 1890s, the black community of Washington referred to it as Charlotte Scott's statue in Lincoln Park. That's how it appears in the Washington Bee. So I love to think of that being her statue, but I would also love to see her. I'd love to see Frederick Douglass delivering that great oration and other. I'd love to see Archer Alexander, the man who is the model for the enslaved man rising. I'd love to see him standing. After all, he fled slavery in Missouri during the war. So I think Edna's exactly right. I agree 100%.
Well, thank you so much. That takes us to the end of our time. This conversation could go on and on. And thank you so much, Edna and John, for joining us today and for sharing your insight. We hope that all of you at home enjoyed our conversation with Dr. Medford and Dr. White today. We will continue to respond to your Facebook and Twitter comments and questions that we didn't get to during the live session. Please consider making a financial gift to Ford's Theater to help support our mission and work. You may do so at fords.org/donate. If you are interested in learning more about Abraham Lincoln and Frederick Douglass, our audio play by Richard Hellison, Necessary Sacrifices, will be available for free streaming beginning Monday, March 12th through May 30th at fords.org. We hope you'll join us here again for our next cabinet conversation on April 15th, 2021. Until then, stay safe and well. We'll see you next time.